Now we'll be focusing on the resistive load inverter. Yesterday we just made a comment that the type and characteristic of the load device will determine the characteristic of the overall inverter. Okay, now it needs to be mentioned here that mostly the driver transistor remains an enhancement mode NMOS transistor. Okay, whereas the load device, that is called the pull up device, the driver transistor is called pull down device. Okay, for the obvious reason that the job of the driver enhancement mode transistor is to bring down the output voltage level. Okay, we are taking the voltage level between the drain and source of the pull down driver enhancement mode device, NMOS enhancement mode transistor. Whereas the job of this pull up device, why we call it to be pull up device, is it is because the responsibility of this load device is to pull up the voltage as near as possible to the power supply. Okay, so that's why they are referred to as pull up and pull down. Now, to start with, for simplicity, if we have a passive pull up load, then what will be the characteristics? For that, firstly, we have to identify the operating regions of the enhancement mode driver transistor. Okay, over the frequency, over the voltage range. So assume that here you are applying a step voltage, but step voltage, not step voltage actually, you are going very slowly, say infinitesimally slowly, you are increasing the voltage starting from the zero. So as long as Vin is less than VT0, so enhancement mode device is in cutoff region, whereas if you increase it VT beyond VTO, okay, you are positively increasing that. Now, so long as, and also when the voltage grows above VTO, that this device starts conducting, and as current starts flowing through this resistance, so voltage along drop across this resistance takes place, and the VDS will be gradually decreasing. Okay, but this is the nature. Okay, so here we are plotting a voltage transfer characteristic of this typical device, let us say that's inverter made of the passive load. Now here, as we can see, that if we take into account that the zero bias threshold voltage of this enhancement mode device is 1 volt, so we need to consider only the VTO, okay, because of the fact that source and body both are shorted to ground. Okay, so no need of taking the substrate bias effect. Substrate and source both are grounded, so this means that the threshold voltage of this is always VTO. And suppose it is 1 volt, then when the input voltage exceeds 1 volt, okay, after that what we'll see, that only the carriers will start. So as you know that the threshold voltage is a minimum gate to source voltage, okay, that will lead to generation of a channel, and after that, as you increase VGS beyond VTO, what will be the physical mechanism? More and more carriers will be drawn from the source, and they will start their journey towards the drain. That means a current conduction will be taking place, right? Okay, so that means carriers will move from source to drain. That means the conventional current direction will be from drain to source. Now, as current starts increasing, more drop takes place here and the voltage starts falling. That means the output voltage, which is taken across drain and source. Now, here then it will go through the salient voltage, which we labeled as VIL. That means it is the voltage at which point the slope of the output, the voltage transfer characteristic curve will be -1. Okay, so what will be the operating region of this device? The inner is any problem? Let me see, bad network quality. Okay, I believe that.
Yes.
Yeah, any problem, let me know. If at any point of time, if you miss my voice or something, or the screen is not clear, just stop me there and then I'll try to take action. Anyway, I hope it will be a good discussion today. Right. So that means as the drain to source voltage falls, okay, it will definitely pass through VIL. But the region of operation of this transistor, the enhancement mode driver transistor, will be saturation. Why? Because VDS is quite large, nearly just a few volts drop from 5 volt. Sorry, few tens of volts or So that means from 5 volt it has dropped to 4.5 volt or something. But what is this voltage? This is quite small. Okay, just above 1 volt. So say 1.5 volt. So 1.5 volt minus 1, that means VGS minus VTO, is definitely lower than VDS. So that means this device will be in saturation. So here we are underlying the operating regions. Okay, so long as this range is obeyed, so the device is saturated. After that, when Vin exceeds Vout plus VT0, then it will be linear. So this linear, that means transition from saturation to linear regimes of operation will happen somewhere when the device is in this sharp, falling curve. That means the numerical magnitude of this, of the slope of this curve will be exceeding 1. Okay, at some point of time, it will go from saturation to linear. Okay. From the time that input starts getting bigger than Vout plus VTO, so that means you can understand Vin equal to VGS and VTO. So VGS minus VTO is exceeding VDS, then obviously that this enhancement mode device will be in linear region, okay, or resistive region. So I believe that is clear. Now, it is our next effort to find out the algebraic expression for salient output voltage VOL, then VIH, VIL. Okay, so we'll do all these things, including VM, that means what you call the inverter threshold, inverter switching threshold voltage. Okay, so that also will do. Now, as Vin is increased beyond VTO, driver MOSFET is initially in saturation, right? Since its VDS exceeds VGS minus VTO, load current is this. Okay, this is the expression for saturation current. Okay, now with increasing input voltage, output voltage Vout starts to fall. Driver MOSFET as Vin is increased beyond VTO, driver MOSFET is initially in saturation. Since its VDS is greater than VGS minus VTO, so load current is this. Okay. With increasing Vin, the output voltage Vout starts to fall. Now, let me see, one call has come. I have to stop the call. Let's see. Okay, so here, with increasing input voltage, output voltage Vout starts to fall. Okay, and so the this is the current through the resistance, and here it will be the linear region current. So actually, the current through this resistive load will be the current through this device, because we are neglecting, although there can be capacitive load here, so we are neglecting any current to the capacitors, because we are taking into account the steady state or DC characteristics. So whatever current flows will be flowing through power supply, starts from power supply to the resistive load and the driver transistor. Okay. Now, to calculate 5 critical voltage points which determine steady state input output behavior of the inverter, right? And VOH equal to Vout equal to VDD minus RLIR. And for input voltage less than VTO, driver transistor is in cutoff region. Okay. So at that point of time, the current through the resistive load as well as to the device is zero. Okay, because no channel is provided by the driver enhancement mode transistor. So output voltage is VDD. Okay. So that means the VOH is can be taken to be power supply voltage for this inverter, this resistive load inverter. Next, VOL. So VOL means that input voltage should be equal to VOH or VDD, which you have just found out. So then that if you write the Kirchhoff's current law expression at the output node, so current through this is VDD minus VOL by R. And what is the current through this? Because this device is in saturation. So this will be, this device will be in linear region. See, VOL means what? The input voltage is VOH, okay, and output voltage is VOL. That means VDS equal to quite small, right? So VGS minus VTO is greater than VDS. And what is that current? That is Kn by 2. Kn, I believe all of you can recall. So underlying, what is the expression for Kn? That is mu mobility into COS gate capacitance per unit area into WYL, the aspect ratio, right? Multiplied by 2 into VDD minus VTO into VL minus VL square, right? And the current through resistance is VDD minus VOUT by RL. Okay, now we are doing it algebraically. So after doing the algebraic manipulation, we find that this involves a quadratic expression involving VOL. Now this quadratic equation in VOL, two possible solutions are there, right? And we have to take the solution which is admissible. Okay, that means this is this, VDD minus VTO plus 1 by K and RL. So you understand that the discriminant of this quadratic equation is, this is like x square plus ax square plus bx plus c equal to 0. So x equal to minus b, this is discriminant is square of this minus 4 times this. Okay. Now here we see that this the quadratic equation plus minus. Okay. That the positive root we have to neglect because that will take us to some value above VDD. Okay. Clearly that cannot be. VOL is quite small in magnitude, right? So the product here we find we have to algebraically we have to take the negative root. Okay. So VOL equal to VDD minus VTO plus 1 by KN RL minus this. Product KN RL is an important design parameter for determining VOL. Okay. So now you see here what are the parameters. Please pay attention. VTO, this is the technology parameter. Okay. We cannot change it. Means for a particular technology node, it is same. VDD is the power supply ports. Although we can afford to change it, but normally for a particular class of designs, VDD is kept fixed. So here only Kn multiplied by RL, this parameter, okay, this is within our control. And that too, what we can change RL or else WYL, right? Mobility we cannot change. Mind you, Kn is what? Mu n into COX multiplied by WYL. So mu we cannot change, gate capacitance per unit area also we cannot change. Instead WYL we can change. That too, the channel length is kept fixed for a particular technology. We can change only W, that means the width of the channel, width of the transistor, and RL, the value of RL. So product, that's why we have written that the product KNRL is an important design parameter. Okay, when you are taking into when you are discussing about the design of this inverter involving a passive load, okay, resistance, this product KNRL is an important design parameter for determining VOL. Okay, right? I hope it is clear. Okay, so remember that product KNRL is very important. And what is KNRL? Also, we shall have an in-depth analysis. This can be related to the impedance ratio of the pull-up device and pull-down device. We'll do that. So before that, let me now talk about VIL, that is the lower input salient voltage at which the slope of the VTC is minus 1. So at Vin equal to VIL, dBin equal to minus 1. And output voltage Vout is slightly smaller than VOH. Okay. So Vout is greater than Vin and the driver is in saturation. VIL is just, you shouldn't forget this VTC. That means when we are taking into account VIL, note that input voltage, the VGS has just exceeded the VTO. Okay, and VDS is quite large. So what will be the region of operation of the enhancement mode driver transistor when I am talking about Vin equal to VIL? Note that output is quite high. So that means what will be the region of saturation? What will be the region of operation? Who can answer? Let me just see. Say, for example, Ambuj, are you there? Ambuj Shukla? So when we are considering VI equal to VIL, what will be the region of operation of the driver? Ambuj, quick.
Sir, in saturation.
Yeah, very. Thank you. So that is the answer. That means this we have to consider. That's why we have identified the region of operation when we are going to discuss about different salient input voltages and also output voltage. So while we are discussing about Vout equal to VOL, that point of time, the device was in linear region, okay, because VDS is quite small. But when we are discussing about V input equal to VIL, then the input voltage is quite small and output voltage is quite large. So hence the region of operation of the driver transistor is in saturation. Okay, good. So then if it is so, then we write the expression for the saturation region current, that is Kn by 2 into V minus VT whole square. And that again, at this output node, we can apply Kirchhoff's current law. Okay. And so this is VDD minus V out by RL equal to this current. And what we do, we have to consider VIL. So what we do, we differentiate the expression with respect to input voltage, because that is the chief independent voltage. So minus 1 by RL dV out dN, you can easily understand. Okay, and setting dV out dN equal to minus 1 at this point. So equating VIN to VIL and setting dV out dN value to be minus 1, we get VIL equal to VTO plus 1 by KN RL. So here also you see in the expression for VIL, okay, this is technology parameter, whereas KN RL, this product, we can somehow we can change for our convenience. Okay, so again, within KN, we can just tamper with W, not with anything else. RL is the resistive load value. So value of V out when V equal to VL is found by substituting 3 to 1. Okay, right? So actually, why this is important? What VIL is important? Because we need to calculate the noise margin, and noise margin of any gate, logic gate, here we are talking about inverter. So noise margins are also of importance, right? So noise margin on the lower side is VOL minus VIL, and noise margin on the higher side, NMH equal to VOH minus VIH. So that is VTO plus 1 by KN RN. Okay, and what is, and next, we are taking the algebraic expression. These are no less important, dear friends. Okay, later on, we shall substitute this with the numerical quantities. Now, value of output voltage when input voltage is VIL is found by substituting 3 into 1. So that is what V out, V in equal to VIL. So how do we find it? We have to substitute here, and we found V out, right? So that is, we can find it in this manner. So V out equal to VDD minus KN RL by 2 into VIL minus VT whole square, right? And just substitute in place of VIL, you prove this, and you get it to be VDD minus 1 by 2 and 1 by 2 into KN RL. So here also you see that KN RL plays an important role. This KN RL, the product, is of utmost importance, as we shall see. Okay, I hope you have understood so far. If any doubt, just let me know. Okay, next we are going to the higher salient input voltage, at which point also the slope of the VTC equals minus 1, right? So from the voltage transfer characteristic, it is seen that here also we are at this point, and at this point the device, which region of operation is there, that we have noted down, it is linear. Why it is linear? Because VGS is quite large at this point, so VGS minus VTO, and you see the VDS has quite come down a bit. Okay, so for simplicity, we can say that VDS is just above VOL, okay, is above VOL definitely. That means it is above VTO, but it is not so large that will make the device go into saturation. For all practical purpose, it will be in linear region. Okay, so that we have to assume, and we can also prove it, right? VGS minus VTO is greater than VDS. So that means when we are talking about input voltage equal to VIH, for all practical purpose, this enhancement mode transistor is in linear region, right? So that's why we have to take into account the linear region current expression, the OR equation, okay, right? So from voltage transfer characteristic, it is seen that when V in equal to VIH, the V out is slightly greater than VL. So VDS is less than VGS minus VTO, or transistor is in linear region. So applying Kirchhoff's current law at the output node, VDD minus V out by RL equal to KN by 2 into this. And differentiating both sides of 1 with respect to input voltage, one gets minus 1 by RL dV out dN equal to. So you differentiate this expression with respect to input voltage. Okay. So as you can see, so that means 2 into V in minus dV out dN plus again dV in. So this becomes 1. So you can easily get it, 2 V out, right? Now what we do at V in equal to VH, dV out, this slope value is minus 1. So set the value of dV out D equal to minus 1. The slope of the voltage transfer characteristic at input voltage equal to VIH equal to minus 1. So you put the value equal to minus 1 and then equate V into VIH. Then you get this expression, the equation 2 transforms into equation 3. And then you find VIH equal to this. Now here we see that output voltage we have to find out. This is unknown. Okay. And also VIH we have to calculate. Only things constant here is video and K and RL is fixed. Okay. We can, if need arises, we can change this. But for the time being, it is constant. So what are the unknown? Output voltage is unknown and also input voltage we have to calculate. Now, so why, how do you calculate? This and this we can simultaneously solve through another equation. That is equation 4 and equation 1. So using equations 1 and 4, we can simultaneously solve VIH and output voltage. Okay, so here are the expression. Output voltage we can solve here. I have done it yesterday. You just see that a lot of cancellations will take place and you will find that V out equal to 2 by 3 into VDD by K and RL. So that means obviously the output voltage is root over 2 by 3. Yes, any doubt? Okay. So output voltage corresponding to input VI will be root over 2 by 3 into VDD by K and RL. Okay, just see that. Yeah, please mute your mic. Can you mute your mic? I don't know. Right. So, yeah, if you have got any questions, just stop me then and there. But otherwise, please, I request all of you to keep your mic muted. Okay. So, this is the thing. And from here, having got the expression for output voltage, you put it in equation 4. Okay. That means substitute this with root over 2 by 3. And VIH, you get it like this. So in this expression also, in the expression for the higher salient input voltage, you will find that the product K and RL assumes importance. Okay. VDD is the design parameter. It is fixed. VTO is technology parameter. It is fixed. Only K and RL you can vary. So in order to obtain VIH to a desired value, only thing you can do is that K and RL you can tamper with. Okay. Increasing or decreasing RL, increasing or decreasing W. That's right. Right? Clear? Now, please come to, so just to make the matters complete for the sake of making the discussion complete, what we do now, you see NML, the noise margin on the lower side is VIL minus VOL and NMH on the higher side is VOH minus VIH. So this can be found out. Okay, because VOL, we have found out VIL and VIH. So now we can calculate. To find the, this is called the inverter switch, inverter switching threshold voltage, and VM, as you can remember, it is the value at which input and output are equal. So if you draw a unity slope straight line through the origin, so that will intersect the voltage transfer characteristic at the point where input voltage and output voltage are equal, and this point is called the switching threshold voltage, inverter switching threshold voltage. And at this point, as input and output are equal, so VGS equal to VDS, right? So obviously VGS minus VTO will be less than VDS, and hence the enhancement mode transistor, driver transistor will be saturation. Okay, clear? So now we try to find out the expression of the VM in terms of the design parameters. So what we do, simply write VDD minus VM by RL, because output voltage equals input voltage, equal to that current through the enhancement mode driver transistor, which is in saturation. So input voltage is Vm, right? So that's why we write Kn by 2 into Vm minus VTO whole square. And again, we get a quadratic equation in terms of Vm. Here you see that this is the way you get it. So which one you are going to take? If you take the negative root, then it means that the Vm is less than VTO, but it cannot happen. Vm is definitely appreciably higher than VTO. So hence you have to take the positive square root. Okay. If you take the positive square root, this becomes a, the expression becomes of this form. Okay. And note that here I take your attention to discuss about this K and RL. You see, that means, and we have shown the curve for the voltage transfer characteristic for different values of the product K and RL. Okay. So if you see Kn is what? Kn equal to the transconductance mu n into epsilon Ox by Tx and multiplied by W by L. So Kn RL is what? It is Kn RL means the product. It is proportional to the ratio of RL and L by W. L by W gets into the denominator. We write it as L by W PD. PD stands for pull down, right? And RL is the impedance of the pull up device. So as if we can write it that the product Kn RL is the ratio of the impedance of the pull up device and the pull down device. Pull up is the resistive load, the passive load, and the pull down device is the driver or enhancement mode transistor. So see that although it is a enhancement mode transistor, but the length to width ratio of the transistor can be related to the impedance offered by the pull down device. Okay. So as one increases Kn RL, okay, or ZPU by ZPD, how we can do that? Let us see what happens. That means we can explain why with increasing value of Kn RL, the curve shifts leftward, and why with decreasing value of Kn RL, the curve shifts rightward. In order to explain that, I have written this. Please pay your attention. That means the product Kn RL, we can relate to the ratio of the impedance offered by the pull-up device here, the resistive load, and the pull-down device. Okay. So as one increases it, what happens? You see, how we can increase? Either you can increase RL, or you can, denominator of the Kn RL lies L by W. So what we can do? We can, I can decrease ZPD or I can increase ZPU in order to increase, right? All of you agree? So if you have to decrease ZPD, we have to increase W. Okay, that means make the device conduct more current. Increasing W will lead to increase of current, right? Because always the, as you have seen in the expression of current, W lies in the numerator. Okay, or I can increase RL. Whatever I do, that means either I can decrease ZPD or I can increase ZPU. So one can increase ID for same voltage. Suppose I decrease ZPD. Decrease ZPD means, say, increase W. L by W is in the denominator. So if you do that, current will increase. That means having done that for the same earlier voltage, I'll get more current. And more current means what? If the enhancement mode device is allowed to conduct more current, then it will decrease the output voltage more. Okay. That means in order to do that, the downward slope will increase. Okay. That means it will be shifted towards the towards the left. Because for the same voltage, see, input voltage we are varying. Okay. So for the same input voltage, now more current will be flown and more current will be conducted, means the drop will take place more across the resistive load. So that means the VDS will be less and less, right? So if the VDS has to be less and less, obviously the curve has to shift towards the left. Okay. So one increases ID for same voltage and achieves faster drop of Vout. Okay. So that is with larger transition region slope and lower value of VOL. Okay. And also correspondingly lower value of the switching threshold voltage. So larger Kn RL ensures that the voltage transfer characteristic approaches that of the ideal inverter. Ideal inverter means, as you have seen, it is a brick wall type of response. It just goes straight horizontally and then falls vertically. So if you keep on increasing Kn RL, in effect, in the process, you will shift this voltage transfer characteristics towards your left. Okay. I hope you have got it now. So on the other hand, if you decrease Kn RL, it will be equivalent to shifting the VTC curve towards the right. Okay. So if you shift the VTC towards the right, what will be the effect? You can say the value of VM will increase. Also, value of VO, your VIH will increase. Okay. So on the other hand, if you shift towards the left, it means that VIH now, it will be earlier. So VIH will be smaller. Okay. And VIH is smaller means, see, VOH remains VDD. So VOH minus VIH, that means the noise margin on the higher side will increase. Several aspects you can note down. That means the effect of increasing Kn RL, how you can do that? By increasing RL or by decreasing ZPU. For decreasing ZPU, you have to increase the width of the transistor. If you do so, in effect, what you do? the switching threshold voltage decreases, the VIH decreases, the noise margin on the higher side, it will increase because NMH is equal to VOH minus VIH. I hope all of you have got it. Still, if there is any doubt, let me know.
Sir?
Yes, yes. Yeah.
Sir, how you have written LYWPD equal to ZPD?
Okay, okay, yeah. Yeah, thank you. So, yeah, the question is that why ZPD can be related to this K and RL? Yeah, right. So, the answer is this. You see, gain is what? If you expand gain, it becomes mu n to Cox by WIL, right? All of you agree? So, mu n Cox is the transconductance, process transconductance, and WIL is the aspect ratio. So, gain equal to WIL, right? And gain multiplied by RL means RL upon L by W. So why do I write? Because you see, these are not within my control. These are fixed. Okay. Mu n, epsilon, OXTX, all are fixed by the technology. Right? That is gain. So I can write gain RL equal to RL divided by L by W and all these parameters. So if you take this as a proportionality constant, it becomes gain RL is proportional to RL by L by W. But L by W is a geometry, simple geometry. L is the channel length, W is the channel width. Okay. Again, a class of design, the channel length remains the same. In fact, for any technology, you will find that channel length, nobody tampers. Only one can tend to increase the W, the width of the transistor. Okay. You got it? So that gain RL equal to RL divided by L by WPD. And why we call it to be resistance? Yeah, that is also important. That means resistance offered by the transistor is written as L by W. For that, you just take any expression of the current of the MOS transistor. ID is equal to what? The quadratic factor on VDD is there. And this factor mu n Cox into W by L is there, right? So now, if you take V by W, it will become, okay, the expression will become V by W will be proportional to L by W because other things remaining same. Okay, other things remaining same, that you will find that the current equal to this expression Kn that involves this multiplied by voltage in quadratic fashion. So here you will find that V by I, that means the resistance, will be proportional to L by W. Hence, for simplicity, L by W ratio, we can say that is as if that is the resistance offered by the driver enhancement mode transistor. Okay, this you can write for any NMOS transistor. Okay, in fact, for any MOS transistor. That's what you got it. So that means length to width ratio, we can as if they are proportional to the impedance offered by the NMOS transistor. Got it. So that means if you have to decrease, in order to increase KNRL, either you can increase the numerator or decrease the denominator. If you have to decrease the denominator, then W has to be increased. And if you increase W, then current will increase for the same voltage. And current will increase means that it will be pulling down the voltage, the output voltage, quicker. Okay, and earlier, that means for the same output voltage, for the same input voltage, whatever was the expression for the lower value of KNRL, now with increasing value of KNRL, the output voltage will be coming down, means will be less at this with the increased value of KNRL. Okay, dear friends, you got it? Right. Now, Now, if we try to discuss about the power consumption and chip area of this particular device, to find the average DC power consumption of this resistive load inverter circuit, consider two cases. One is when the input voltage is quite low, below. See, for all practical purpose, VOL should be lower than VTO. Okay, why? Because inverter means it inverts the voltage. So when input equal to VOH, the output voltage should be VOL. Okay, and if an inverter drives another similar inverter, it is quite desirable that for the first inverter, which is at high voltage, output voltage, okay, input voltage should be high, the output voltage should be as low, so that the next inverter should provide high output voltage. And next inverter voltage, if it has to provide high voltage, it is desired that the driver transistor remains off. And how can the device, how can the driver transistor remain off? So that the input voltage is lower than VTO, right? So with the input voltage of the second inverter being at VOL, you should ensure that the inverter gives high output voltage. So that means obviously VOL should be ideally less than VTO. You get it? Okay. So that means Vin equal to VOL means the transistor is in cutoff region. I hope you have got it, right? So with the driver transistor in cutoff, no current flows, and you can neglect the current through both the resistive load and the device. So DC power dissipation equals zero as the current is zero. But when Vin equal to VOH, then the driver and the driver becomes in linear region, okay, quite high VOH, and load resistor also conduct current, non-zero current. So what is the output, what is the current through the inverter? That is device current equal to resistive current equal to VDD minus VL by RL. Okay. Now for the device current, obviously you have to write KN by 2 into 2 into VDD minus VTO into VDS minus VDS square by 2. That will show later. So assuming that Vin is low, this is a very simplistic assumption. That means the input voltage remains low during 50% of the operation time, whereas it remains high during the remaining 50%. The average DC power consumption of the inverter is this, VDD by 2 into VDD minus VL by RL. Okay. Now, an inverter design problem that we see here. So here you see the practical values we have taken, VDD equal to 5 volt, and the process transconductance, that means the product of mu and COX, is given to be 30 microampere per volt square. Remember that what is the unit of gain, the transconductance is ampere per volt square, or here microampere per volt square, that means current by voltage square. So you can now tell me what is the unit for K into RL. Let me ask some of you. Yeah, let me see. Okay, who am I going to say? Arjit Dubey, are you there? Arjit. So as I've told you, if I ask some question, I find that person to be absent, I'll take that he is not attending the class. So the internal assessment will be affected, let me tell you. So Arjit is absent. Now, Balu Krishna, are you there? Balu Krishna? You're present. Okay. So just let me know one answer from you. What you think should be the unit for the expression K into RL? K, you say it is ampere per volt square.
Yes, sir.
So product K in RL, what is its unit? So that means I have said that K in RL assumes importance. Okay. Now, can you tell me, is it unitless or does it have got some unit? Tell us quickly, unit of K in RL.
Voltage inverse.
Yeah, very good. Yeah. So that means now you see that KN is ampere per volt square and RL is volt per ampere. So it is voltage inverse. So remember that. Okay. So whenever you write some expression, even in your exam copy, please, I tell you again and again, do not forget about the unit associated with every physical quantity or signal. Okay. So as you design the resistive load inverter circuit with VOL equal to zero, so this is the targeted or specified value of VOL. That means the lower significant output voltage, nominal output voltage low. Determine the WL ratio of the driver transistor and the value of the resistor, load resistor L, that achieves the required VOL. So several choices can be there. Okay, to satisfy the specification for the VOL, note that the driver operates in linear region, as this will be less than this. Okay, so we can write the expression of the current corresponding to linear region and VDD minus VL by RL. This is the terminal current. Okay, right. So if we equate these two, then what are the unknown parameters? Only the WL ratio and the RL. The rest of the things are given, because the targeted value of VOL we know. Okay, that is 0.2 volt. Okay, and that is equal to VDS. So VGS, that means VOH minus VTO, 5 minus 1 equal to 4, 4 into 2 into 0.2 equal to minus 0.2 whole square. So I find that only WL is unknown, RL is unknown. These are the two design parameters here. Okay. So I get it to be that it is equal to 205 kilo ohm, okay, or 2.05 into 10 to the power 5 ohm. And note again that it gives us the product K and RL, okay, is equivalent to the ratio of the pull-up resistance and the pull-down resistance. RL is the pull-up resistance, and L by W, you can say that it is a metric for the pull-down resistance, right? It is not exactly the pull-down resistance, but it is proportional to pull-down resistance. Then, you see, for this problem, I can have different objectives. I have to satisfy that for VOL equal to 0.2 volt, which value of WYL and which value of RL I should take. Now, objectives can be different. The different choices we have tabulated here. So, how do we do that? And also, we can calculate DC power consumption. DC power consumption, you remember, VDD by 2 into VDD by VOL by RL. Okay, that is only for this resistive load inverter, not for in general, for all the inverters. So VDD by 2 into VDD by, here you know this 5 by 2, 2.5, 5 minus 0.2, 4.8. So if you know RL, you can calculate the DC power consumption, right? So if you take WY equal to 1, then the load resistance will be 205. So if you increase by a factor of 2, this becomes half. If you increase it by a factor of 3, this becomes 1 by 3 of 205. You can easily see the first two columns. And the third column also we can find it by noting that VDD by 2 into VDD minus OL by RL. Okay, so by putting the different values of RL, we can calculate the power dissipation. And that is in microwatt. Why microwatt? Because microampere per volt square, all these things. So note the unit associated with the DC power consumption. So here, we can have a trade-off between WYL and R. If you increase WYL, RL value comes down. See, dear friends, all of you. And also, the power dissipation goes up. 50 to nearly 60, and this is so nearly six times. And power dissipation is an important aspect when you are acting like a designer. Okay, so sometimes your emphasis may lie on keeping the power dissipation as low as possible. Then you go for this solution. Okay, that means if your objective is to contain power dissipation, to keep the power dissipation as low as possible, then please take up this solution. So keep the power, load resistance as high as possible. WYL is also as low as possible. Right, but on the other hand, if your objective is to keep the area minimum, why area minimum? You see, that means if you have to implement this resistance in integrated circuit technology, two technology lies that we shall discuss now. Okay, that means selection of WYL and RL depends on different consideration, like whether power or area. As we have noted, that power and area are important parameters to consider while designing a circuit. Power consumption increases considerably if RL is decreased and WY is increased. But if the objective is to minimize DC power consumption, choose a small WYL and choose a large RL. But if you choose RL to be large, silicon area occupied will be large, and that can interfere with your objective of minimizing the area. Right. So if you have to minimize the area, you don't care for power dissipation, then you have to take this expression, say WYL equal to 6, load resistance equal to 35, right? So depending on the objective that you have to satisfy, you have to choose one of the solution pairs. So now, as you have commented, okay, that why we have to bother about the area and how to, and why we are so much concerned that a larger value of RL can spend up large amount of area. To answer this question, now we consider cheap area. So cheap area occupied by the resistive load inverter circuit depends on two parameters. One is the WYL ratio of the driver transistor. The second is the value of the resistor RL. Okay. Now, area of the driver transistor is the gate area. Gate area means WYL. And normally, as I have told you, that L we do not interfere with. Only we change WYL. So if you have to increase WYL, okay, so what you have got? You have got, say, a parallel slab, a square slab WL. So what do you do? Place several such slabs in parallel, right? That means this is W, this is L. Say W is vertical dimension, L is horizontal dimension. So what do you keep? One top of another slab you keep, then connect them, okay? Then you get a lower resistance transistor. That means the channel length same, only channel length remains the same, but you are increasing the width of the transistor. So that means just place one slab, okay, and another slab. This, suppose four slabs you keep in keep such that the W get in series. L is just one. Okay, so W by L, you just put one on top of another. W is the vertical dimension, length is the horizontal dimension. Then you get as if four slabs in parallel. Okay, so there then the resistance will be 1/4. Okay, so W by L is proportional to the admittance offered by the device, right? So if you have this solution, the sixth one, with W by L to be large and this is to be low, will definitely have less area. Why? Let us answer. So two types of technology are there. One is the diffuse resistance, the second is the polysilicon undoped resistance. Okay. Area of the driver transistor is W by L. Gate length is kept at its smallest possible value for a given technology. The gate area means is proportional to W by L ratio of transistor. Resistor area, that means the passive resistor, depends strongly on the technology used to fabricate the resistor on chip. Two technologies we can discuss with. One is the diffuse resistance. Now look at the first one, the diffuse resistance. Here you see, that means say, and also the N-type diffusion gives you less resistance compared to P-type diffusion. Why? Because you see the resistivity rho equal to the reciprocal of conductivity and 1 by ND Q mu. Okay, so mobility of N-type is more compared to hole. So that's why we don't go for P-type diffusion, but we go for N-type diffusion so that the resistivity is less. Okay. Is fabricated on an isolated N-type or P-type diffusion region with one contact on each end. So this is one contact, this is one another contact. The resistance depends on the doping density of the diffuse resistor or dimension. And there is a L by W ratio of the transistor. Here I show you. So you assume there is a slab. It is a parallel pipette length. Okay. This is a conducting wire. So current flows in this direction. So L, W, and the T, the thickness. Then what is the resistance offered by this slab, this rectangular parallel pipette slab? That is RVB equal to resistivity rho into L by area, cross-sectional area. Channel length, okay, the length, and divided by the cross-sectional area, there will be W multiplied by T. Now, suppose you make it to be a square slab, then L by W is L by W equal to 1. So then there will become R equal to resistivity by thickness. So for this question, resistivity is inversely proportional to the thickness. So narrower is the device, I mean, it will offer more resistance. It is called ohm per square. This is the sheet resistance, okay, or sheet resistivity. Practical values of diffusion region, sheet resistance varies from 20 to 100 ohm per square. That means very small value it gives. So if you have to realize as high as say 1 kilo ohm and you get 20 ohm per square, then you have to put 50 such, see 20 multiplied by 50 gives you 1000. So you have to keep 50 such slabs in series. Okay, that means after this you horizontally place again and slab. Then to its right you place another slab. Like that you get a long length of conductor. Okay, just by putting the slabs in series. So long L means you cannot put it in a straight line. So to contain the area, what you do, you make it in a serpentine shape. Like a snake. Okay, so this serpentine shape while you go about is due to your objective to contain the overall area. Okay, if you put it in a straight line, then huge area will be consumed, right? So to realize resistor values of tens or hundreds of kilo, one requires large length to width ratio. Placement of these resistors on chip in serpentine shape for compactness requires much more area than the driver MOSFET. For the driver MOSFET, you see, this is a what you call a layout diagram. Layout diagram will be very important henceforth, dear friends. So you see, I am trying to give the symbol of metal by in a monochromatic diagram. You have to distinguish the metal from the diffusion and from the polysilicon, and also the contact card. So metal and diffusion. Diffusion, I draw like this, metal with a shaded region. So ground and VDD are given like a metal, is drawn in metal as well as the output. Polysilicon, I draw like a rectangle with small circles. And filled in square, okay, that means darkened square means these are the contact cut. So contact cut you require between metal and diffusion. like here also between metal and division. But polysilicon and the underlying division, there is no contact, mind you. Polysilicon passes over a different plane. Okay, between polysilicon and division lies the oxide, semi-oxide or insulator. Okay, right. So here you see that if you have to accommodate a large value of resistance of the pull-up resistance, serpentine shape will be unavoidable. Okay, and you have to put like this. But for the driver transistor, this is the channel length L and this is W. So WYL can be 4 or 5. We can put it like this. So not much area is consumed by the driver transistor. But compared to that, the area consumed by the passive resistor will be huge. And that can be quite a bit of concern to us. Okay, right? So if you have to reduce this area, what you can do? You take the second technology, that is polysilicon or undoped resistance.
Sir, can you once again explain the how you place the resistor to increase the resistance?
Okay, Amit. Amit, I am explaining that. See, when you are taking into account n-type division in order to implement a passive resistor, right? Got it? So then n-type division, the resistivity is quite small. Resistivity is 1 by sigma. So you can easily understand that resistance offered by each slab will be quite small, say 20 ohm or 50 ohm, let us say. Now, if you have to get a resistance of 1 kilo, say not 1 kilo, you have seen you may require resistance as high as 34 kilo, right? So even if you require 1 kilo ohm, and if you have got a resistance of say 50 ohm per square, then how many squares you require? You require 20 squares, is it not? Get it, Amit? So 50 ohm per square, and you have to realize 1 kilo ohm, how many squares you need to put in series? How many? Amit, tell the answer.
20.
Very good. 1000 divided by 20. And if it is as low as 20, you require 50. But you have to place them in series. How you can place? Can you put it like this? Then start, put one slab after another. It will be huge. It will be consuming a huge area. Rather than that, what you do, if you do it in a serpentine manner, okay, then the area you can control a bit. Right? So suppose you put one slab like this, then another slab, then another slab. Okay, so you can easily imagine, you can easily draw it on a chart of paper, on white paper, and you find that putting all the slabs in directly one after another in a straight line will consume huge amount of area. But rather than that, if you go for serpentine shape, okay, the area can be controlled. Right, you can definitely control the area. Some other problems will be there, like current flow, it will be like this, it will flow. But the area will be controlled. So you cannot do without going for serpentine shape. Get it, Amit? Okay. Just this is a mechanism to control the overall area. But still, sir, it will eat up a lot of area. Yes, yes.
So we are placing these cuboid slab in the stack toward the B direction.
Exactly. That means, as I've told you, see, this is the channel length, this is the W. Okay. You have to increase the resistance. So increase the resistance means put the lengthwise, you have to put the slabs. And if you have to decrease the resistance, you have to put the slabs widthwise. Okay. So you can say that along the length of the channel. Along the length of the channel. See, current will flow like this. Right? So, I mean, lengthwise, you put one slab after another. So that the overall resistance will be increased. Okay, overall resistance will be increased. If you have to increase the conductance, then you have to put it widthwise. So the current can flow here, but width is increasing. So with increase of width, the resistance will decrease. With increase of length, the resistance will increase. Okay, once again, with the increase of channel length rather than width, the resistance offered by the resistance will increase. But if you place W-wise, then what will happen? The resistance will decrease, the conductance will increase, right? I hope you have got it. So if you have to control the area, second choice is polysilicon undoped resistance. To save the silicon area, sheet resistivity of the doped polystructure is very small. Doped polystructure is 20 to 40 ohm per square. But for undoped, it can be as large as a 10 mega ohm per square or 1 mega ohm per square also, right? How do you do that? For that, you selectively dope it. That means you see that the resistivity of a doped polystructure can be controlled by controlling the dopant density. So if you control it, you can If you keep it fully undoped, then polysilicon gives huge resistance, so 10 milliohm per square. But that can put difficulty in trying to realize a resistance as low as a 34 kilo. Okay, so what do? You control it selectively by controlling the dopant density. So with lower resistivity, okay, you can make the size requirement smaller and smaller. So what is the benefit of undoped polysilicon resistor? It is having a high value of resistivity, so the area requirement will be quite small. But there is a drawback. What is the drawback? Drawback is that resistance values cannot be controlled accurately. That is true. See, sometimes I need a resistance of, say, as you have seen, the requirement. I may require 41 kilo or say 34 kilo to have it accurately. That becomes complex, even though you go for a polysilicon or undoped resistance. You have to break it. That means the W has to be controlled. Channel length has to be controlled. Okay, and correct control may not be possible. Okay, so resistive load inverter, with undoped polyresistor, certainly allows us to conserve area. Okay, but controlling of the resistance value becomes difficult. And if it is so, then you see its effect will be on getting the proper value of VIL, VIH, VOL also, right? So yeah, and if VIL, VIH cannot be correctly controlled, okay, then I cannot control the noise margin also. And remember that for logic gates, a proper VTC and proper noise margin is of utmost importance. Okay, without that, you cannot get the logic equation. However, for memory circuitry, okay, simple inverter operation will be perfect. Not sir, much need to have a perfect VTC.
Yes, sir, we have another class. Sir.
Okay, sorry, Dilesh. Okay, just to complete this discussion about the if you are asked to compare the choice between diffuse resistor and polysilicon or undoped resistor. If you have to maintain a proper VTC, if the design becomes that for a logic gate, okay, go for diffusion. And if the design is for memory, which depends mostly on low power operation, okay, and perfect VTC is not much of a concern, just rough inverter operation will be fine. Then for memory circuitry, go for polysilicon undoped resistance arrangement for passive resistor. For logic gates, which depend on perfect noise margin and stress is on VTC and noise margin for logic gates, okay, there you go for diffuse resistance. But for RAM cell, memory cell, where primary stress is on reduced DC power consumption, so higher is the, see, as you have seen, higher is the value of resistive load, lower is the power dissipation, okay. So that's why for memory circuitry, if power dissipation is our major concern, okay, so then go for high value of resistive load. For that, you can take undoped resistor. Okay, good. So any more doubt you can ask. Otherwise, I'll request you. Because you have to attend other classes. Thank you very much. Just let me tick that in. It's okay, fine. So yeah, thank you very much, dear friends, for your attention. Okay. So what?
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you. So we'll meet next on Monday at 10 o'clock. Thank you. Please stay healthy, stay well, stay safe. Thank you, dear friends. All of you. Bye.